Welcome. My name is Christine Beckett, and it is my very great pleasure and honor to introduce my dear colleague, Irene Feher, who is about to give a presentation on pop voice. Irene is a Montrealer who did her first degree here at Concordia Music Department with her voice teacher, Ben McGuire. From there, she went on to a doctorate of music at McGill in performance voice, correct? Working with Winston Purdy. And after coming back to Concordia as a very cherished voice teacher, she has taught any number of wonderful students. She ran a beautiful improvisation workshop that's a little bit on hold now, post-pandemic conditions. That was called the Collaboratory. And that in turn has spawned another program for students who love music here at Concordia, not all in the music department, some of them are engineers. That's called Live Your Music. Irene is an accredited teacher of the program called Music for People. She's a full member of the National Association of Teachers of Singing. And she works for her own pop voice progress with a wonderful, wonderful voice coach named of Idri Means Weekly, who established the CCM, Contemporary Commercial Music Vocal Pedagogy Institute at the University of Shenandoah. I long to hear you roll away. Okay, and Irene's going down there this coming July 2023 to receive some graduate training. I give you Irene.
Thank you very much, Christine. So I would like to begin by giving an acknowledgement to and thanks to Christine Beckett and to Eldad, our department chair, for allowing me to come here and present this wonderful topic, which is teaching pop voice. And also to Michael Zajner, student in electroacoustics here at Concordia, who designed this wonderful poster. So, say what? It's an introduction to the study of pop voice. But it is a growing form of study. And I'm just going to relate my own experience as a singer and teacher so that you'll be able to relate it to the outline of this presentation. About 1985 to 1992, I was performing in cover bands and as a studio musician for songwriters. And I was singing a lot of pop, rock, dance, music, and doing the club circuit. And I was diagnosed with something called pre-nodules. And the rigorous performance schedule that I had to endure was starting to affect my vocal quality. I was experiencing vocal fatigue. So with that, I sought the training of a voice teacher and became so fascinated by how the voice works. At the time, of course, most voice teachers were predominantly classical, or at least the ones that I could find. So I came to Concordia, where I studied classical voice and continued on in classical voice, thinking that that would help me sing popular music. But I could never quite cross the bridge. So I became an established classical singer. I love classical singing, and I still sing classical voice today. Fast forward to 2003, the International Conference of Physiology and Acoustics of Singing. And there's two teachers there, Jeanette Lovetri and Lisa Popale. And Jeanette Lovetri stands up and says, how come the only voice, or 90% of any kind of academic study on the voice, is only on Western classical voice? There's so much more. There's so many more different kinds of singing. Since that time, the study of voice has begun to expand more and more. And in 2014, the University of Shenandoah presented at the National Association of Teachers of Singing Conference in Boston. And they did a call out saying, do you know that as of 2011, only two universities in the United States had a program in popular voice? So again, there's been more expansion, more study, and what is happening is that, yes, there is lots of musicology work in the study of popular musics, but now there is more and more performance and looking at performance studies. Post-secondary education programs are expanding, and we are expanding beyond classical music and jazz studies. The voice, of course, is very central in popular music. There are challenges. We have to rethink how our university programs are taught. Classical music really follows the reading of the score, musical literacy. Popular musics are oral traditions. They are taught through listening and participating. Evaluation. So you will see as we start to compare classical and contemporary voice, evaluation becomes very subjective. In other words, it's very centered around individuality and what that person is trying to convey with their singing voice. Rubrics, what makes a good popular music performance? And finally, the pedagogical approach, which is very different from that of a classical pedagogical approach to teaching voice. There are many common misconceptions, and I'm going to give you the main ones. If I learn classical vocal technique, I will be able to sing pop to a certain degree. You will open up a light head voice and you will probably have more flexibility in your range. But the structures for classical singing will not serve you if you are planning to belt or rap. Belting is harmful. No, it's not. When done properly, belting has as much risk as singing in the opera house. So it can be learned, and it's actually very safe for the voice. Pop singers don't need lessons. Okay, let's stop here for a moment. There are wonderful natural singers who have gone into the studio, and then they've been signed up with a record company, or they wind up going on tour, because right now touring is the way to earn income. Well, we're returning to that now, after the pandemic, of course. A lot of natural singers start to discover that the rigors and the demands of being on the road begin to wear down their voices. So they need to learn techniques and strategies to keep their voices healthy for the rigorous demands of touring. So I want to clarify a little bit of terminology that you will see coming through. So one is CCM. CCM means commercial contemporary music. This was a term that was put forth by Jeanette Lovetri, and it's basically, it's been adopted by the National Association of Teachers of Singing, and it's a generic term for all musics other than classical music. And that includes musical theater. And it's music that is developed for consumption, simply put. So as we think about comparing, I think it's good to work from the classical singing end of things, because this is what we see the most in university programs and has been what we see the most in university programs. So classical singing and commercial contemporary singing are different. So objective measurements, acoustic or spectral readings of the voice signal reveal that we can objectively measure these differences. And also subjectively, they are very different in how they are perceived, and depending on who perceives them. To amplify or not amplify, this is a big question. So of course we know that most popular musics are amplified. And performance practices. How are they performed? Where are they performed? And technique. Technique is very different. Technique and the approach to teaching is different. So I began with an objective measurement through spectrographic analysis to measure the acoustic sound quality of a voice. So this is an example of what we call a spectrogram. So what we see here in the y-axis is we see over here, this is the measurement of frequency. This here, this is time. And here what we see is an organization of harmonics. The voice is quite a complex sound. What we hear might be just one sound. You're hearing my voice, but it's actually constructed of different harmonics. You've heard of the term a voice print. This is, in effect, a voice print. Where we see the lighter shades is where the frequency has a higher amplitude. That means it's louder, more powerful. So if we think about objective measurements for these voices, a classical voice has harmonics that rarely extend beyond 5 kilohertz. In CCM voice, the harmonics can span quite high to 10 kilohertz, and many of them are noise elements. So in classical voice, the overtones are harmonic. It has been described as a very clean sound. Whereas in popular voice, there is more of a presence of non-inharmonic frequencies. So with these, they can also be perceived as roughness, edge, brassy. Formant zones are discernible. So, question here is, what is a formant? When you hear vowels, you are hearing formants. Formants are resonances of the vocal tract, okay? So, the vocal tract is your vocal resonator. It's your mouth, the back of your mouth, and your throat. So when we are hearing vowel shapes, what we're hearing is changing the form of the vocal tract. So the formant zones are very, when we read it on a spectrograph, are very discernible. I will have a visual for you, so you will get to see this. Whereas in CCM voice, the formant zones are relatively indistinct. In classical singing, there is a consistent vibrato, so that's like a vibrancy in the voice. Whereas in CCM voice, the vibrato is less consistent. There is less of it. So I'm going to play for you an example, so you will see the spectrograph.
Call me that I've done all right. Gives me the elbow.
Bucknell, so this is like big opera, you know, a Baroque opera signal. You could see it's quite different from what we saw. We can see the vibrato. We can see the waves of the vibrato. And the sound just looks more organized. So this is a live spectrogram. So this is me speaking. Classical voice is designed to project in a room. So the high harmonics and the clean harmonics allow me to sing without a microphone. So now I'm gonna sing something a little bit different. You can see the difference, and if I amplify it, I'm gonna go and very different looking voice print. That if we can measure these differences, there we have our apples and oranges. So then we have our subjective or qualitative perceptions. So perceived level of effort. Some people hear an opera singer and think this is pushing, this is huge effort. Some people will hear a belter and think this is huge effort. But if you might watch a performance of Frozen, for example, and you're watching someone like Idina Menzel, which might sound like she's pushing, but she's singing 6 to 7 shows a week. So she's able to sustain that. Both approaches to singing require practice and skill. Basically, classical singers learn to naturally amplify their voices. Generally speaking, we will sing in churches or halls that might be acoustically treated, set up so that like the Maison Symphonique, which is incredible, you could hear a pin drop in that hall from the stage. It is designed so sensitively. So no matter where you are in that room, you can hear a violin or a voice. It's just phenomenal. So we have this beautiful, clean sound generally in a very quiet performance space. Contemporary voices are amplified. In many instances, the arenas or the venues will be much larger. If they're not large venues, they may be nightclubs, or they might be bars, they might be restaurants. So the environments will be more noisy. They may also be outdoors. So the singers will have to be mic'd. Of course, there are classical venues outdoors, but the sound engineering for classical music is very different than that for popular musics. The microphone is an extension of the performer's voice. This is called a dynamic microphone. So with a dynamic microphone, depending on my distance to the microphone, it will change the quality of my voice. So if I come really close to the microphone, and if it's mixed, or if I do the metal thing and put my hands around here, and if I go, it sounds huge. So there's microphone technique that is used, and belt singing might sound very loud, but when you hear it unamplified, it's not as loud. It will not carry like a classical voice. So we work with a dynamic microphone and with the sound engineer. Studio production and mixing enhance the overall vocal quality. So the sound engineer becomes your best friend. So anyone studying contemporary voice needs to learn something about sound engineering. It's very important to understand some of the basic terminology so that you are able to communicate with somebody who is mixing your sound for you, or if you show up yourself and you have, most people have to do their own sound mixing. So understanding what a monitoring system is. So the perception, if you've never sung amplified before, it's a very different experience because you're hearing your voice, first of all, coming back to you from a speaker. It is being processed electronically and it's coming back to you. So you're hearing it from a third person perspective. If you're learning how to sing popular music for the first time, you probably do not have access to a microphone. So you're in your living room and you're thinking, wow, I sound like nothing like the records. Well, of course you won't sound like the records because you are not singing through the sound system. We cannot have that expectation. So singers will use a monitoring system. A wedge is kind of a small speaker that will be on the stage or mounted on the stage so that the singer can hear themselves. Or an in-ear monitor, so it's placed right in your ear so you can actually hear what's happening. One thing I always tell anyone in music is to be very careful about amplitudes, which is how loud things are. When you go past 90 decibels, you are really starting to harm your ears. So you need to really take care of your hearing. And for classical musicians, it's the same. Anyone who has played in an orchestra and sat in front of the brass section will relate. Exactly. And sitting in a voice studio with an opera singer as well. It's very loud. Reverb, which sounds kind of like echo, adds depth to the voice and roundness to the sound of the voice. So it's like the sound of the voice in a large hall. Compression reduces the overall dynamic. So by dynamic, the volume range of the voice. So what you might hear is a very tiny little sound will sound very big and intimately present in the microphone. Encourage my students to always listen to unplugged versions of their favorite artists. It's quite revealing because then you get the raw, unmixed version of what that voice sounds like. Fortunately, with YouTube, we're able to access some interesting pieces. I'm just going to show you two short clips. First thing that we notice is how different they sound unprocessed, not in the studio, live, just filmed on a phone. Last but not least.
This is Corey and this is Avon, and we're going to sing a bunch.
It's very different than what we hear in the studio. And so when we hear them unplugged, it feels more relatable. So in performance practice, one thing that's amazing in CCM music is the wide variety of genres. We know this, it's not just pop. Pop is like one thing, but there are so many different kinds of pop, so many different kinds of rock, so many different kinds of metal, so many different kinds of rap. It is huge. So I always encourage students to do is understand the music that you are singing. So if you're singing, you love Amy Winehouse, you want to know the roots of Amy Winehouse's style. What were her influences? And how far back do these influences go? So of course, if we just draw back on Amy Winehouse, then we know that we need to look at African music, gospel music, rhythm and blues, and then going in maybe even to Motown and Stax and the different forms of R&B style that brought us towards Amy Winehouse's style. So as we understand this genealogy, then what happens is we have a deeper cultural understanding of the music that we are actually singing. And there's these incredible projects online. So one of them is Music Map, and in here, but if I just go to Pop, so they've created a whole genealogy chart. You can go and trace all of the roots of the music, and they have taken a great deal of time to write about these genres. So we'll go into country because that's sort of a comfortable place for me, but you've got bluegrass going down to Bakersfield, going down to Nashville, and then you've got progressive and outlaw. So you can just trace, and then they've got all of the connections with other musics way beyond the scope, but just this site itself is almost a musicology class. And I will show you another wonderful resource that I have sent students to, and this one is called Every Noise at Once, creating maps of all kinds of different genres. So I went into genres by country. So we can look at all of the different genres by country. So Newcastle, Indie, in English, so Brazil. My scope is relatively narrow. My training was mostly in the United States. So even on Canadian music, my knowledge is based on my own experience, but Canadian music is a growing field, and more study of it, it would be great. So if I come back to the graph in Every Noise, is that you can actually look up little sound samples for each of these. You can look up a particular artist. I've just put in Blue Rodeo. So we have Canadian rock, Canadian indie, country rock. So if I just click on Canadian rock, here we go. We've got all different kinds, all different artists. So what's really important for the popular singer is, yes, you choose a song and you say, this sounds really cool, but there's so much more to it than that. So it's understanding the genealogy of the music as well as its social and cultural contexts. Vocal stylisms. Vocal stylisms was developed by Edry Means Weekly, and what it's really understanding are certain performance practices that we hear in various genres of singing. You'll probably notice when you hear a pop singer try to sing classical music, it sounds kind of wrong. Or when you hear a classical singer try to sing pop music, it sounds kind of wrong. And so we learn to develop our listening, our active listening skills, to be able to recognize them. So you have just these things that when you start to listen to voice, you can actually begin to chart. So one of the things you'll do in contemporary voice study is you would actually listen to a performance and you will chart all of these things that you hear. So a cacciatura is like a pop appoggiatura, so it sounds a bit like a hey, hi. So a bit like that, bending, added blue notes, oh, I go. Amy Winehouse was doing a lot of those. Borrowed notes, so borrowing a note from the phrase before, I like to go. Breathy sounds that come in, that is so. Crying, ha, ha. Fry, I don't know. Fall offs and fall ups, where the phrase might go up and it goes to not a definitive defined note. So, hi, hi, fall off, fall, those are fall ups, sorry, fall offs. Hey, it doesn't really end on a note. Flip on sets, Papa Pudgetura. Hey, growl, ha, moaning. You'll hear a lot of moaning, especially in certain genres of music, the blues. So a lot of the rhythm and blues sound, that kind of a sound, neighboring tones, passing tones, retracting tongue, across the water, screams, shadow vowel and release. So, I love ya, yo, yo, hey, yeah. And then shout. Hey, what's up now? Yeah, uh-huh. Slides. Ah, we'll hear a lot of that. Swinging the notes. So that's a lot of taking eighth notes and putting them into the dotted eight format. Da 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 da. Tails. Ah. So little decorations, turns. Ah. Vibrato, delayed vibrato, ah, waves, oh, yodel or register shift, Of course, in phrasing, it's the same thing. We have anticipation, so you might be coming a little more quickly as the phrase begins. Back phrasing, so we get this feel, syncopation, swung eighth notes. And of course, improvisation takes the form of licks, riffs, and wails. A lot of imitation of the electric guitar. And licks tend to be shorter, little melismatic phrases. Riffs are big. So if you hear Beyonce or Jessica Weiss, Yeba, a lot of these singers will use quite big riffs, John Legend. So it's very, very flexible riffing. Onsets, which is how we come on to a tone. In classical singing, we talk about a balanced onset. But in popular singing, you will not hear that. You'll hear a lot of high, breathy, cry, creaky, I don't know, flip, fry, glottal click. Growl, yodel or register shift, releases can be ends of notes, abrupt, so really like breathy, fall offs, fall ups, fry, shadow vowels, So we start to attune our listening to these practices. So especially for classically trained singers, I get a lot of classical singers who say, I'm singing pop, but I just don't seem to hear or get the sound right. It's missing. Something's missing. And so this sensitizes us to these performance practices. One of the big differences is that commercial contemporary music is more rhythmically driven. Classical music is melodically driven. Popular musics are much more rhythmically driven. and we learn to feel the pulse as well with the text. It's very rhythmical. So, you know, you will not sing a pop. They're going to have different kinds of rhythms in the voice as they sing. The voice, there's a lilt in it. Again, a lot of this is influenced by African-American speech. I recommend it for everyone who is interested in R&B music or hip-hop. You must watch the documentary Talking Black in America, because then you really get to understand where this comes from. So that we are not doing cultural appropriation and imitating a way of speaking without understanding where it comes from. Singing is more conversational, and whoops, I jumped here. Learn to feel downbeats and upbeats. So we have one, 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 and. So learning to feel upbeats, downbeats. Overview of how the voice works. Like every sound, and here we're talking about a musical instrument, a voice has an energy source. That is the respiratory system. We have a vibrating source. That is the vocal folds, also known as the vocal cords. And then we have the resonator. So the resonator is basically your vocal tract, which is your mouth, the back of your mouth, your pharynx, and also smaller resonators are the nasal cavity, the epilarynx, which is just above the larynx, and as well the larynx itself. You have to think of the vocal tract as the filter of your voice. Resonance has a profound effect on the sound quality of the voice. And this is a huge factor when we start to differentiate styles and vocal practices. So the respiratory system is basically made up of the diaphragm, which is the primary muscle of inspiration, the lungs, the abdominal muscles, which help us push out breath. Shh, shh, shh. You'll see athletes when they're breathing quite heavy, they're but we don't use that much when we sing. Also, all of this is supported by dynamic physical alignment. So what you will notice is that singers, big performers on big stages, the bodies are very aligned. They look very dynamic. For me to project my voice like this without a microphone, I have to make sure that I'm holding a very dynamic stance. If I let go, I'm gonna have to really force my voice to speak, and I'll get very tired. The vocal folds. So there's a lot of misconceptions about the vocal folds. Many people think, how many vocal folds? Well, I have 88 vocal folds, or they're standing up in my neck. But we actually have two vocal folds. And they are located in the larynx, which is a sphincter. The larynx is actually protects your airway. When foreign objects come in your airway, the larynx closes. And it also has an epiglottis, which covers the larynx when you swallow food. So it directs the food right behind your larynx to your esophagus. But the larynx also has the vocal folds, which vibrate and make sound. And if you look at your pinky fingernail, that is about how long your two vocal folds are. They're very tiny. We talk a lot about the thyroarytenoid muscle, which is the body of the vocal fold. And we talk a lot about the cricothyroid muscle, the CT muscle, which is a muscle that when it contracts, tilts your larynx and stretches your vocal folds. Here, if we were looking down into a human larynx, so how would that look? Is if I actually took a camera, put it in my mouth, way to the back of my mouth, and there was a little camera on the edge facing down, it would be at the back of my mouth, and it would be looking down into my larynx. This is your trachea, your windpipe. These are the two vocal folds. this is like a big leaf-shaped thing at the front of your larynx, which is called the epiglottis, which closes down to protect. And then, of course, the larynx itself is made up of cartilages. So that is our vibrating source, the vocal cords. And then here's the vocal tract that I spoke with you about. So the larynx is right here. It's housed underneath your chin. It's here in your neck. And supraglottis means everything above the vocal fold. Okay, here's that epiglottis that I mentioned. And when that folds over, that's going to protect. They didn't label it, but behind all of this is your esophagus. And then you have over here subglottis underneath the glottis, and then you have your trachea over here. Here are the lips, your mouth. This big thing is the soft palate, so here is just space. There's the back of your pharynx, there's your larynx. So that camera would have been looking down into your larynx. Again, a more simple image. What I love about this image is it shows us how big our tongue is. The tongue is probably one of the most important parts of your resonator, and how you place your tongue will have a profound effect on the quality of your sound, which I will show you as we go through vocal techniques. You have your nasal cavity and the soft palate, the famous soft palate here. So many of us talk about nasal resonance. It is not used a lot in singing. Some people do use it, but it's used mostly for nasal consonants. You will know the nasal cavity. So if you hum, join me in a hum, and in mid hum, just plug your nose. So let's do it together as a chorus. And the moment you plug your nose, it stops. So that's how you get to feel your nasal cavity. So I just wanted to set this up because as I talk about vocal techniques, it will hopefully make a little more sense to you. So classical follows a particular set of aesthetic rules and traditions. Contemporary singing is a much more individualized approach. For both, we look at functional vocal techniques. When you understand functional vocal techniques, it makes it much easier to work on an individualized approach, because then you understand how your instrument works, and you're less likely to harm yourself. So classical looks for chiaroscuro, a balance of light and dark. It's a beautiful round sound that is consistently balanced throughout the range. In contemporary singing, it is more speech-like. And as you saw when I went through the vocal stylisms, there is a variety of sounds. The classical voice is lyrical and it is more melodically driven. The contemporary voice is more conversational. It is more rhythmical. And you might have some lyrical elements or scream or moan or cry. Again, in the classical voice, we saw the even vibrato throughout. And in the contemporary voice, it's much more limited. In the classical voice, lyric diction, a more formal sound to the voice. So we call it Mid-Atlantic English or Hochdeutsch. If you're singing in German, it's much more formal. Whereas in contemporary singing, it's going to be a much more colloquial sound, the sounds of everyday speech. So the big thing when I work with contemporary singers, well, I'll teach them functional vocal exercises. We'll try to understand how the instrument works. And the first question I will ask is, does it feel good? That's really important. Is it sustainable? Could you do this? Could you call this up and could you do this? If you had to do this, now it doesn't mean you're going to scream an entire concert. If you're doing even death metal singers, there's back and forth. There's a lot of guitar soloing. But could you still sustain this through an evening concert? Could you still do this for 30 to 60 minutes? And so we're looking at this balance. Output. You're getting the sound that you want. It is powerful enough. It carries and it works for you. Energy level. Healthy speech is about a 3 to 4 out of 10. When you go to 5, you're really working high power. Hey! Whoa! Ha! Huh, what? That's about a 5. 6 is going to go into strain. So when you're performing, you always want to be between 3 and 4, with an occasional 5, depending on the music that you do. Effort, that's the effort. Effort level always between 3 and 4 with an occasional 5. People confuse effort with energy. Energy is presence. Energy is a well-maintained body that is fit, good posture, great, like most singers that I know who are out on tour, they're taking great care of themselves. They are vocal athletes. So you're really taking care of yourself. I had a singer that I teach. She did a performance where she was having to stand way high. She was elevated. She was swinging herself down this cage, like singing, while singing, performing. She was lying down on this floating table. She had to perform under all these conditions. She did great. But it's this idea of balancing output, energy, and effort. Breathing technique. So with classical voice, we talk about a low, deep breath for long phrases. Okay? In popular singing, it's more speech-like breathing, short phrases. Both require flexibility. Flexibility of the abdominal muscles, flexibility of the diaphragm. So this is to sustain a consistent airflow that allows us to sing through a long phrase and through a range of sounds. Energy and intention, because you need good breath energy and it needs to be consistent if you're going to work on what we call vocal mix. So vocal mix is being able to transfer through the lower chest voice up to the head voice without too much visible cracking. So there's a lot of pop singers who will say, I've got this hole in my voice where I have no power. I don't know what to do. My voice suddenly turns over. So how do I work on my voice to even out that sound? So part of it is being able to sustain that energy and intention. Registration is a very important piece. For more mezzos and sopranos, it is going to be a more head voice dominant production. For contemporary singing, we have head voice, mixed voice, and very chest and or chest dominant. Again, this depends. If it's a more belty style, Adele uses a much more chest dominant sound, but she does flip into mix and she also flips into head voice. Register balancing in classical singing for a consistent, even sound quality. So tenors, for example, sing in a full chest voice, voce plena. But as they go higher in their voice, there is lengthening of the vocal folds. There is a form of vocal mix. We don't call it mix, but it sounds seamless when a tenor goes up into the high range of his voice. But what is happening technically is there are changes in the larynx, the lengthening of the vocal cords, increasing the vibration, good contact of the vocal folds or vocal cords. Again, same thing. So for a variety of sounds, register balancing for contemporary singing. You want to have something that can carry. So we talk about thin fold, which is not all classical, but definitely in the higher range of the voice. You are going to have a thinner vocal fold production. So as I'm waving my hand, so here's my hands, this would be looking at the vocal fold structure from the front. So if you were to see a larynx, it would be very, very tiny. You would, if you ever see this in an MRI or an electromyography, it looks like a little butterfly when the vocal folds are vibrating. When you're singing, there's, especially in the high range, there is a thinner fold, so there is a little less vocal fold contact. When you're doing full throttle belting, there's going to be a lot more contact of the vocal folds. So it's going to be a good, strong contact and even vibration. Not squeezed, not pressed, not blown apart by too much breath. Thin fold and thick fold. And then, of course, we have that balanced tone that we talked about, light and dark. And then here we might hear more calling, yelling, sirening, rap, whispering, mumbling, evenness of tone throughout the range. Remember, we have to, as classical singers, project the voice in a hall without amplification. There is a variety of tones throughout the range, and it's okay if you are not loud all the time. That's a misconception. You're hearing the voice processed, you're hearing it compressed. So we might be thinking that the CCM singer is loud all the time. They are not. Vowel modification with the goal of lengthening the vocal tract. So when I do a vowel modification, I am taking a deep breath, my tongue is dropped in the back, it's open, it creates a beautiful, rich sound. Whereas over here, vowel modification is with the goal of shortening the vocal tract. So working on the changes, so the resonance. So here we're talking about registration, which is hand in hand with vocal resonance. You are controlling vocal resonance. That is the shape of your vocal tract. That is how you are really having a very strong influence on your sound. So approaches to classical and contemporary singing are diametrically opposed. They are different. The goals are different. If you try to use classical technique to belt, you will hurt yourself, okay? So classical creates a more pear-shaped tone. That means that the back of the throat, the tongue is dropped, the pharynx is more open, vowels are taller as the jaw is released, and it's almost like an inverted megaphone of sorts. Whereas with contemporary music, the pharynx is smaller, you have a more wide and lateral mouth. So round and tall vowels, bright front vowels, more open mouth position. So this open mouth position, a little more tall, different shapes. So it's a little more closed, lateral mouth, especially on lower notes. Round, more round, lip rounding. Now some lip rounding is used here. So it's bright and wide, but you'll see some belt techniques that are a little bit inspired with a more rounded mouth to create a richer tone, like kind of bugle lips, you'll see that. Here the back of the tongue is released and down. Here the tongue is more forward. Here I am talking about the tongue. How often have you thought about your tongue and what it's doing? So singers use proprioception. That's the ability to notice what's happening with their body parts as they are doing things. So the relationship of the body parts one to the other. We never learned how to speak like that. We learned how to speak through imitation. So becoming aware of how to use your tongue is really, really huge when you're singing, because this is making a big difference in the shape of your vocal tract. The back of the mouth, same thing. We're not aware of that. So the wide, because that's, you're only aware of it if, you know, you might be yawning, or if you might, if the finger goes too far back, you would probably gag. So you don't want to be aware of the back of your pharynx. But the back is more narrow for contemporary singing. It is wide and open for classical singing. Again, lower larynx from the breath and a higher larynx for contemporary singing. The soft palate generally is more raised in classical singing, so we feel that little smile in the cheeks, and that raises it. And then over here you can have high or low, because there are some singers who really kind of want to do that sound. And it's a desirable sound. As a voice teacher, I am style agnostic. I am not going to judge somebody for the sounds they choose to make. Because in contemporary singing, it's that person's voice, not my taste. It is about, what do you want to do with your voice? What do you want to express with your voice? Vowels in classical singing are rounder and taller, and in contemporary singing, they tend to be bright forward vowels. They can also be distorted. I forgot to mention that. You know, it depends on the style. E and U vowel shapes will encourage head voice. E and A encourage chesty sound. So a lot of the exercises that we will do to help people learn how to belt is using the bright baby A, and we'll even do a sticking out tongue, A, A, to get a brighter sound without harming the voice. If I try to go with a heavy classical voice, I will hurt myself. Nasality and twang. So here's a reminder. Placement, you cannot physically place the voice. Placement is actually a sensation of resonance. So we have something called interoception, where we sense our body internally. So sensing the resonance of the voice is something that is very subjective, and it's also very subtle. Depending on the shape of the vocal tract, the singer will experience that as a placement of the voice. Well, I kind of feel the resonance above my lips. Melissa Cross, who teaches screaming and heavy metal singing, will always have her singer sing above the pencils. So she'll have them put a pencil in their mouth. The sounds always have to be above the pencil, out there. Now, the singer is not trying to place the sound there. As they release and are using less effort and getting the right shape, they are experiencing their resonance above the pencil. They're experiencing the vibration and the resonance of the voice a particular way. For a classical singer, you will never hear the full throttle voice that you have. You will hear a tiny little voice projected to the back, because it's already gone to the back of the hall. And remember, we never hear ourselves the same, no matter what room you sing in, no matter what equipment you are using or your sound person, you will never sound the same. But what do you have to rely upon? That sense of your resonance. So twang is something that a lot of popular singers will work on. It is quite a bright sound. It's a narrowing at the back of the throat, just above in the area epiglottic sphincter, which means it's like right above the epiglottis. The best way for me to demonstrate it is to do a witch sound.
Oh, my pretty tongue!
And I'm not hurting myself. So that's AES. Oral twang is also, it's in the mouth, so it's versus nasal twang. So when I'm going, hey, there's nothing in my nose. So that's oral twang. Hey, is it more of a nasal twang? We hear it sometimes. So I want to play a pretty cool example. So Tiffany Mosley is a gospel singer. Her high notes are just incredible. that is a prime example of AES. There's actually, they call that kind of gospel singing. There's a sound there. There's a whole doctoral research being done right now. They call it squall. It has a very particular sound quality. And they talk a lot about that AES. So articulation, again, classical. So we're talking about vowels and how we use speech. So classical singing is very vowel dominant. Contemporary music is much more speech-like, so you will have a more even time ratio of consonant to vowel. In classical singing, you have much more vowel, so the ratio of vowel to consonant could be anywhere like 10 to 1 time ratio, or even more. Whereas in contemporary singing, the time ratio could be something like 2 to 1, or even 1 to 1 of vowel consonant. It can also be vowel even 1 to 5. Okay. Classical is more pure vowels. We're very, very conscious about sustaining a pure vowel on a long note. And in contemporary singing, you'll hear more co-articulation. You will hear different shapes. The vowel might morph or change as the singer holds long notes. You will have clean consonant to vowel, vowel to consonant joins. It's very, very pure in classical singing. In contemporary singing, you might have longer consonants and you might have something called co-articulation, which is something like meh or muh. Belting. The belt sound is a combination of register and resonance. It is not forcing the voice, okay? Belt is not pure chest voice. Belt is affected by resonance. And resonance is affected by the vowel shape. So how we shape the vowel will affect resonance. Classical technique will not work for belting. Belt is not yelling or forcing. You should be able to belt soft. So when we're training people how to belt, one of the first things we'll do is get them to get that speech voice quite low in volume. And then learn to bring the tongue forward to raise the larynx. So we're really looking for lots of flexibility. So these are a few examples of belt. I figure it's good to hear a 13-year-old.
The side of my future lies beyond the yellow.
About output, energy, and effort. Just as we think about the, again, output, energy, effort, and vowel shape, and mouth shape, the structure, the posturing of the body. So we use a lot of this. It's great to watch singers. We don't think about that. We get lost in the performance. But when we start to notice what they do and try to figure out what is it that they're doing to create these sounds, it really makes a difference as we approach healthy instruction. Flexibility of the voice, finally, this is such an important piece. The voice needs to be flexible. We need to be able to move it in different ways. So just two really wonderful examples. So it's worth thinking
about. I'm reaching out to you.
Relaxed posture.
Can you hear my call? This hurt that I've been through.
Gesture and music.
I'm missing you. I'm missing you like crazy.
Raising the chin.
Shorter.
So it's just a wonderful example of what we mean by vocal flexibility and how important that is. And one of the last examples I have here is this is an example of cross training. So in musical theater today, students who want to go into musical theater, the old expression, triple threat. You're a good singer, you're a good dancer, you're a good actor. Being a good singer means that you are extremely flexible and that you can sing many styles, because now musical theater is featuring a lot of rock, pop, heavy rock, jazz, country, legit musical theater style, which is much closer to classical style. So we'll watch a short excerpt of Kristen Chenoweth going between musical theater belt, classical, and jazz.
Her Revali, she's getting like her name.
Watch
is Alice, who answers a cappella.
Originality, of course, the idea of originality is take a cover song and make it your own. So when a student comes in to study contemporary singing, the idea is not for you to sound like the record or the artist. You need to find your own expression.
Bust the windows out your car.
The original.
And though it didn't mend my broken heart, I probably always have these ugly scars. But right now I don't care about that part. I bust the windows out your car.
I bust the
also end with this lovely young singer is that please know it's not all about being loud. And that's a really important piece to mention. The big stuff is flashy, it's super exciting, but it is not what every singer wants or needs. It's really about being yourself. In the apprenticeship and study, we are breaking certain traditions. We are, our views are broadening. Classical singing is always viewed as highbrow, elitist, and predominantly white space. It is also a formal form of education, which means it is very master teacher centered, following particular rules, guiding the students towards achieving a particular aesthetic goal. Popular music has been traditionally viewed as lowbrow. It's more inclusive, which means it might seem simpler, less complex. And it has its roots in Black, North American, Indigenous, Irish, Hispanic, Latinx. And it is achieved through a more informal, or what we call non-formal, education. So formal learning is, again, very structured. It's top-down learning. Whereas informal and non-formal learning might not be graded. It is much more student-centered. It is really looking at supporting what the student is going for and really helping that person through experience and being actively involved to shape, to help them express what they wish to express. And informal, and it's also apprenticeship in a sense. Informal learning is DIY. It's sitting at home watching YouTube videos, trying all kinds of things, experimenting on your own. So this helps us to really rethink, how do we program the learning for singers? So we encourage student-centered learning. We're guiding the student to find functional ease, flexibility, strength, sustainability, and endurance. So what does this involve? Active listening, observing, watching lots of singers, learning your rhythms, scales, chords, keyboard, and guitar proficiency, percussion proficiency, improvisation, social and cultural immersion, love the music, love the people. These are some pioneering voice teachers that I mentioned, and just a list of resources which I will be sharing. And we did it! Yeah! So we have 10 minutes for questions. I'm sorry about the toggling, that lost a lot of time, but I would, if you have any questions, I'm really delighted to answer any questions you might have.
I noticed that for all of the belting videos, it's pretty much on an ah or something like an ah vowel. I'm wondering whether you ever... if the singer has to belt on an ooh vowel, whether they're taught to have to like borrow heavily from an ah, so a u might turn into a yeah, something.
In the back, you'll have an ah shape.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You won't hear really super high belt on ooh, though.
I'm sure it's much more.
Yeah. Even Freddie, there's one part, get him in the green, on with the show. O's are deadly. Anything that's like ah, oh, is just so, so difficult. So he's putting in a bit of the scream in there. It's, but it's very, very difficult. Yeah. But definitely in the back, you'll have that eh, ah.
I just wanted to say, well, it's not a question, it's a comment. I really enjoyed your demonstrations very much. And I see that you're very much more versatile than I thought in what you're able to do. I heard some sounds, and just to put a name to them is really interesting, you know what I mean? I like that analysis, and I like the examples of the singers, the different singers you put up. That was really great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's really just... I think that the thing that I love is I love everything. I'm curious about everything voice. And I'm curious about the functionality, how the voice is capable of so many different sounds and how they can be achieved effectively. That's what really, really fascinates me.
Cool. You mentioned that there had been at one point only like two universities in the States, or I don't know, where there's popular music being offered, right? Do you believe that that door is starting to open now? There's more of a push.
So Jana's question is, music, popular music programs in 2011, there were only two programs. The answer is yes. I have not checked the latest statistics, but there are a lot more popular music programs. For fun, I looked it up in Canada, and I think I saw three universities.
But are they universities or colleges?
Universities.
Okay.
So I saw UBC, University of Western Ontario, and I think it was U of T. And a lot of them went under the guise of sound recording.
Or is there must be a program for musical theater too, right?
Musical theater, there's a lot more musical theater programs.
Right.
But in commercial contemporary singing, there's fewer. But what's happening, like at Shenandoah, Matthew Edwards teaches popular singing, but a lot of the musical theater students go to him,
yeah,
and Edry, because if you hear a lot of the musical theater, it sounds like a lot of contemporary music. So like Bright Star is country, Dogfight is very contemporary country rock, Jesus Christ Superstar, very, very rock, Hadestown, like there's all different mixes. And sometimes in the same musical theater piece, you may have to sing multiple styles. Beetlejuice is another big one, you know, it's very heavy, a lot of very, very driven singing. But there are more musical theater programs than there are contemporary singing programs. Fortunately, it's growing. There's a lot of it growing because the demand now is for touring artists. So, yes, you're going to go in and record, but with streaming, your main source of revenue will be in performing and touring.
Right.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Irene.
This has been Irene Feher on Pop Voice at Concordia Music Department.